when your person is in power, then you tend to get a little complacent. Lefties will start to prep a little bit more, and people on the right are gonna succumb to normalcy bias. You should seize upon whatever window of opportunity presents itself to do the non-panic prepping stuff. So, we've averted a civil war, and it appears as though now we've bought a bit more time to do a bit more long-term focus preparedness. Now, this all presumes that nothing happens until Inauguration Day, and that Trump doesn't just continue the same policies of the previous administration, which very well could be the case, especially in the Middle East. There is a very high chance that those policies will be continued and in fact magnified. Part of the reason why Netanyahu put a new defense minister into that position was so they'll be able to prosecute the war in an unfettered manner. The previous defense minister had lots of reservations about going to war with Iran due to manpower concerns and just the lack of logistics required in order to partake in such an operation. But the new administration has essentially given Benjamin Netanyahu the green light to go to war with Iran. So we know that that is definitely on the horizon. The great thing about a shakeup in the government is that in the very least, it derails the inevitable trajectory towards global conflict that we are on. Whether that's for the better or worse is yet to be known. But this is a great time to start thinking more about long-term preparedness, because everybody, I think, has been prepping out of haste lately because, you know, people have thought that things are impending. And I still think that that is the case, but there might be a brief reprieve and restructuring that perhaps allows for deferment of those hostilities, maybe a few months, a few years. This is not a time, though, to get complacent. I recall watching a video in, I think it was 2017 or 2018. It was a very prominent YouTube channel. I distinctly remember the title. It was Prepping is Dead. And then I think I made a response to that video saying that prepping is far from dead. And this is back in 2017, 2018. We all know what happened from 2020 onward. And of course, this was because Trump was in power at the time, because a lot of preppers, especially at that period of time, which is not entirely the case today, leaned right. And so when your person is in power, then you tend to get a little complacent. You tend to think, there's not really much reason for this because the potential for catastrophe is much lower. If you do think now that we've bought ourselves a bit more time, this is a great opportunity to hone those skills that you're going to need to ride out a long-term disaster. If there's something that you wanted to learn that perhaps you were on the fence about because you didn't think there was enough time before, now is a great opportunity to do that. If you wanted to make a longer-term investment, like in terms of land or maybe some bigger ticket preparedness item, maybe now is the time to start looking at that. I would always advise people to plan long-term, but prior to November 5th, I would say that there was a greater sense of urgency, which it should still be there, because let's say Trump buys you 4 more years. You don't want that to be a missed opportunity wherein you could have been saving money for land, developing those skills that you're gonna need, like hunting, going to the range, taking first aid courses, just doing things that are going to, you know, extend beyond panic buying. And I guess this is where you start to see the difference between panic preppers and the intrinsic preppers. Intrinsic preppers, people who are intrinsically motivated, use opportunities like this to try to build up their long-term preparedness. But a panic prepper, somebody who gets into this because they think SHDF is imminent, they're likely going to become disinterested. Unless there's like an immediate threat for some people, there is no inclination towards preparedness. Myself personally, as an intrinsic prepper, I take this as an opportunity to start looking at bigger projects that I might not have considered because I was so concerned with the immediate future and the stockpiling mentality. The panic preppers, they're gonna go quiet and they'll be back, of course. But I think that those people who prep like that, realistically, for a long-term scenario, they're not gonna do that well. They'll probably be fine for a regional disaster or short-term disaster, because they don't think long-term. Now, what I expect to see, and it's the same thing that I seen in 2016, is that you're gonna see a political move in preparedness to the left. And we've seen this unfold in ways that nobody expected in 2020, when you had this massive surge of interest in prepping on the side of the left. The preparedness market has been something cornered by the stereotypical right-wing survivalist. But increasingly more so, especially after the pandemic, you've seen a female demographic get more interested in preparedness. And I'm not sure what the exact split is, but females tend to trend a bit more to the left overall. So I think you're gonna see that again. People's concerns about a Trump administration, whether or not they have any merit, or whether or not they're justified, are nonetheless gonna motivate people on the left to take a greater interest in preparedness. And I actually think that's a good thing. It's not a political statement to say that the more people who are prepared, the better. People are fearing a Trump administration, and that compels them to wanna become more self-responsible. Then, in a way, Trump is kinda doing them a favor, right? Because he's forcing them to take their lives into their own hands. Maybe that's exactly what's required for the average Democrat to regroup, realization that you're on your own and you gotta fend for yourself. Necessity is the mother of all creation. People will have to get creative again. People will have to learn those skills. That level of self-responsibility is going to be an empowering thing for them, and that's gonna put less of a burden on society if the shit actually does hit the fan. What will happen on the right, though, is that people, again, will get very complacent. So you'll have this kind of inversion where lefties will start to prep a little bit more, hopefully, and people on the right are gonna succumb to normalcy bias, but only the ones who are panic preppers. The real long-term thinkers understand that 4 years goes by really quick. Let's say you're somebody who is actually concerned about the political landscape, and you think that in 4 years, another Democratic government's gonna be elected, and I'm not saying that's my motivation, I'm quite apolitical. I think regardless of who's in power, foreign policy is likely not gonna change, and a lot of these things transcend whatever sort of puppet they put in front of us. But nonetheless, that might be your motivation. Then think to yourself, what can I do in 4 years? You know, what happens if I work maybe an extra 20 hours a week? Maybe that's gonna get you an extra 100 grand or something like that. And if you put it in perspective like that, well, what can I do with that 100 grand towards preparedness, you know, without having to rely on debt? Because you don't wanna put yourself into debt buying land that you might never use. But you take that 100 grand and you think to yourself, okay, what can I do with that extra money? And then you can perhaps start thinking about, okay, like, do I want to acquire a property? Do I want to just bolster my preparedness supplies? Do I want to go back to school and educate myself on some topic in that 4 years? Do I want to develop a skill or a trade that's going to be useful in the rebuilding process? You can accomplish immense amounts in 4 years. Because if you know that hard times are coming, then working a 16-hour day when times are good is gonna seem like heaven when times actually are bad. You know, seize the opportunity now. Don't presume that there's a peace dividend and it's going to last forever, because it won't. And this is all presuming that things don't go bad under a Trump administration, which they very well easily could, okay? We were fortunate enough from 2016 to 2020 that it was a low intensity conflict environment. There was a lot of photo shoots, a lot of optics, but the realities have fundamentally changed. Trump may have been able to be a de-escalatory force under the circumstances of 2016 to 2020. But if you put that same character in the climate that we're in now, one where we are in a high intensity conflict on multiple fronts, that type of Mercurian personality, when thrown in the ring with a lot of our adversaries, could actually lead to rapid escalation. You should seize upon whatever window of opportunity presents itself to do the non-panic prepping stuff. So there's storing energy, and then there is generating energy. If you look at it that way, it becomes really simple to understand what preppers do. When you think that SHDF is imminent, the only thing you can really do is store energy. You can't focus on those systems that regenerate energy. And I'm not just talking about energy in a fuel or solar power. I'm talking about a broader understanding of energy. That bullet took energy to make. And the only reason why you were able to get that bullet at the price you did is because of this sophisticated supply chain, which runs on oil. And so that bullet took oil and energy to get to you. So if you wanted to make that bullet in an SHDF situation, you know, it would take a lot of energy, right? But to get back to the point, the dichotomy between storing energy and harvesting or generating energy, now is the time that when we're not in a acute crisis situation, you start to focus on those regenerative energy goals. So that could mean anything from the literal harvesting of energy from the sun and trying to build out a larger solar project to learning how to reload your own ammunition. There's a bigger upfront investment of your time and energy, and there's less of an immediate return, but there is a more sustained return long term. Because of the events of the last 4 years, we know that there will be no peace dividend, meaning that countries are now going to be investing a much higher proportion of their GDPs into militarization. That's going to take away from economic prosperity in other respects, and it is going to create immiserating austerity for much of the population. High-ranking admirals within the US Navy have predicted that there will be a war with China before 2027, and that that is inevitable due to something called Thucydides' trap, which is where a rising superpower threatens an established one, and in an attempt to interdict their rise, the established power picks a fight before they can get to a point where they're a true threat. Contrary to what is being told in the media, it was in fact Ukraine, at the behest of NATO and the United States, who initiated, or in the very least, antagonized the Russians prior to the Russians attacking. In fact, the Ukrainians were about to attack the Donbass. That's according to the Russian point of view. Because, once again, Russia was rising economically prior to the conflict. They were becoming more powerful. So NATO, in an attempt to interdict that economic progress, started a war with them. Now everybody's like, yeah, but Russia invaded Ukraine. That's because Vladimir Putin had intelligence that the Ukrainians were going to attack. So his strategy is, if you know a fight is coming, throw the first punch. We're going to find ourselves in that situation again. Whether it's the neocons who infiltrate the Trump administration and start advising him to haphazardly partake in more of these conflicts, or in the next 4 years, they'll elect somebody else who will be more than happy to enter into that conflict. And even if there is no intention to get into a conflict on the part of the Trump administration or whatever administration comes thereafter, there will be provocations and there will be deep state interagency actors who create black swan events in order to justify military interventions. So we could potentially see, you know, attacks against NATO countries, and that might of course be what is used as justification to go to a greater war. The moral of the story is keep on prepping, because we've only postponed SHTF.
The best way to support this channel is to support yourself by gearing up at CanadianPreparedness.com, where you'll find high-quality survival gear at the best prices, no junk, and no gimmicks. Use discount code PREPPINGGEAR for 10% off. Don't forget, the strong survive, but the prepared thrive. Stay safe.